Magavan and Melanine, and well met indeed. I am Arachir Galadirathan, the head of the modding team behind Divide and Conquer, and welcome back to Divide and Conquer as we continue on as the remnants of Angmar. Well, it's going reasonably well-ish, but as reminded last time, or as I was pointed out to in the last video, in a comment, I now border the elves. That underscore, by the way, has been fixed for future versions, or indeed in version 1.2, I can't remember, but... and because I'd sold Ostgelon, or I gave Ostgelon to the Valesmen in an attempt to create that barrier that I have been seeking since the start of the game. And it's gone down okay, but now that we border them at Loonland, they're still going to be throwing through. However, the northern Dunedain are now down to Bardi Donjonak, which is soon to fall. A Numenas in the south here, and then I believe that it may be it, or possibly the castle of Kaloniak down in the south there. So... And with the fall of the Northern Dunedain, the forces of Lindon would become our natural enemy because Bree is still engaged and preoccupied with Dunland, who are performing admirably on the southern front for the forces of evil. Bree are sending some raids and the odd testing attack and probing on us, but they're not doing any substantial damage. Nay, they're not really doing anything, to be honest, because as I say, Dunland is keeping them busy and keeping them occupied, so... We should be okay. Now, just as a point of note, in case I should say anything the wrong way round, this video was recorded before I recorded the faction overview video, and they were both recorded on Monday the 20th. So I might say something, I mean, I doubt it, but there may well be something I say here that's different in that video, despite the fact that they are in different locations. That's interesting. It just told me the ring was in Bree and then took me to the ocean. Fascinating. I don't know what happens when you get the ring as an evil nation. Do you have to then take it all the way to Mordor? Because that's a long old trek. Oh, they've got Arthedain Men-at-Arms. That A has since been capitalized, by the way. I'm pretty sure they've been changed to Dunedain Men-at-Arms as well, so to remove the Arthedain link. I'm leaving a scout there to see if they'll ever get units, which I'm hoping they will, because then we know that the elves aren't going to get it. But also, as this army
I will only address you.
Get ready for makes fighting. Its way south to a Numenas, I'm going to link it up with the Barketta army. So we'll just wipe them out from the Numenas region.
Get ready for fighting.
He's moving in to assist. So if that army is successful, which it probably will be, no Captain Ugrad is only a turn away after that to then take back the village, so we won't lose anything too rapidly. To the bloody Breelanders. In modding news, I don't really have too much news for you, save for the Third Age Reforged mod has posted. I've yet to reply to the gentleman. I probably would have replied by the time this video goes out. But the Third Age Reforged mod has posted an image of a new, unique custom settlement they've created at Karasant, the capital of Dorwinion. And but they've made it purely for the battle map, so that, and it is actually just a battle map, not a town assault map, interestingly, because there's no square. And we're going to lose this. And somebody in the comments of that said image said, you should send that along to DaC. I'm sure that they would love to have it. And I'm sure Arachia can add in the square. And whilst, theoretically, I know how to add in the square, I've never actually done it in practice. So, and also it would mean Karasant would have to be bumped up to the highest possible city level, and I'm not really too keen on that. So I haven't replied to the guy as I've recorded this, but by the time you watch it, I probably will have done. But I'm not going to try and get that Karasant map. So if you've seen that map, I'm not going to try and use it. Oh, you didn't move when I want you to. Oh, I can just move you all in a minute. We can't really. The Dunedain Rangers are going to destroy us. It's my major concern here. And we don't have enough of anything to do any real retaliatory attacks. What was the other unit that was hiding? Oh, bloody farmhand archers. Best we can do is at least try and defend. But... To me, Hillmen. To those of you who I've been asked again about Black Numenoreans in Angmar, and again I say there were never Black Numenoreans in Angmar. There may have been some, very possibly, a tiny number of Numenoreans who may have gone over to the Witch King when Ruadaur fell. Possibly. Oh, it's... Minimized. Oh, I hate it when it minimizes. Map always screws up. See, it's jumping between. Ah, there we are. There may have been a small number of. Oh, they all died. There may have been a small number of Dunedain, possibly, who went over. But that would be, like, if Tolkien never expressly said they did. So if we take Tolkien 100%, then no, they didn't. But with a little bit of fan fiction for, like, games like this, you might possibly be able to say that a few would have gone over. But there weren't Black Numenoreans there before anything happened. All of the King's Men, or what came to be Black Numenoreans, they all landed and established realms in Umbar and further south than that. Any of them that actually escaped, that is, the downfall of Numenor. And it's considered that very few did escape the downfall of Numenor. And in fact, it's suggested that none of the King's Men actually escaped the downfall of Numenor, but some of those who were loyal to Sauron, shout for want of a better word, whilst they didn't escape the downfall of Numenor, they'd already left. So it's like any ships that had already gone to Umbar, maybe on trade missions, maybe just to go to Umbar, some of the King's Men would have been on them, and they then became the Black Numenoreans. None of those who actually fought against the Valar at in the Calabeth, none of those survived. So and certainly none of them went north. So in Arnor, I know in Battle for Middle-earth it says that there are evil men and evil dark Numenoreans and the Witch King calls them over to his cause and blah 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 blah. But that is purely just to add some extra units to that game. That's not... Tolkien never wrote that, and we can't, even from what we do know, you can't suggest that maybe that happened. So, like, when I say that maybe some Numenoreans turned when the Witch King rose up, although we know that they didn't, but you, for a fanfiction kind of way to qualify it, you could say that we know that the Black Numenoreans, or the Numenoreans, have it in them to turn against the forces of good. We know that's true. And we also know that some Numenoreans do harbour a sort of greed and personal desire for power, and they may have seen the turning to the Witch King as a chance to just bolster their own power, but it would have been maybe one or two people tops, even if we did argue it from a gameplay perspective. So there aren't ever going to be Black Numenoreans in any great number in Angmar. The only Black Numenoreans you're ever going to get are those that we have chosen to be the bodyguard of Agendower, because they have come up from the south with him. So, and it's just because somebody asked me again. They said that they'd read somewhere that there were Black Numenoreans and that Carn-dum was likely a Black Numenorean fortress, so can Angmar have Black Numenoreans, please? And again, the answer is no. And the men of Rúadawr, whilst many of the Dúnedain that went into Rúadawr were obviously Dúnedain, the majority of Rúadawr was made up by indigenous peoples, or humans who didn't get the gift of the Valar and the Isle of Numenor to themselves. Isle of Elena. They were just hillmen. They were just wild men. They are akin to the men of Bree, for example. They weren't anything special, and they were changed over to the Witch King a lot easier than the Dúnedain were, because the Dúnedain inherently opposed Sauron and Melkor, or Sauron through Melkor. Melkor through Sauron, sorry, it's the other way around. These men are just not throwing their javelins. Only they're having a right nightmare. In you go. As long as we can kill a fair... I mean, the army that is coming will beat this Bree land army. I absolutely love Bree. Just looking at their units gets me wanting to blaze Bree. I just love them. The simplicity of their nation is excellent. I really like that kind of, like, country bumpkin farmhand army who, at a push, can really fight for their lives and their freedom and their land. But they just can't go toe-to-toe with any of the great warrior nations. And they're fighting for themselves. They're not fighting for world domination. They're fighting to be free. I like that about them. Oh, sorry, I've knocked the desk. I also quite like that they have a... this unit is one of the most medievally looking units I think we've actually got. Certainly a contender. And I've always really liked the Breeland Militia. Always have done. We'll go back to time 6 because we are losing. And so we'll just get it done.
Our enemy has command of the city.
We've only killed 20%. It's diabolical. Oh well.
Our men have fought.
And they're down. I'll tell you what I am tempted to do is to maybe make the captain for the Angmar armies, just so that Angmar stands out a bit more. Now that we've made Ruadauer an Angmar-only feature, so only Angmar and Dunedain get Ruadauer units, I'm quite tempted to make the captain of the Angmar forces a Dunedain, a Ruadauer man. A man of Ruadauer. 59 kills, Snaggerstalk is well done. So Angmar just stands out that little bit more. There's an image of, I assume, Harad. It's a desert, there's a city. So I think I might make their captain a Ruadauer guy rather than... So even if you've got an army of all orcs, the captain is a human. Because that just adds to that twist. Like, there are four orc factions in DaC. Mordor, Isengard, Misty Mountains, Angmar, and Dolguldur. Sorry, five. And each of them is meant to have something that sets them apart. And like, obviously, Isengard is set apart by its heavy armor, like heavily elite troops that are far more readily available than, say, the Uruks of Mordor. They've just got better elites. Dolguldur is set aside by it having that Easterling influence with those like five really uber elite Easterling inspired units, and of course Castellans. And Angmar is differentiated by being a kind of hybrid of those two. It gets some very elite orcs courtesy of its past, owing to like basically suggesting that the power of the Witch King is not entirely dead, and some of his tricks and skills and knowledge has at least endured. And that's part of Angmar's thing. So they've got some orcs that are very, very powerful with the two Witch Realm units and the Guardians of Carn-dum. But also Angmar's little kind of niche selling point, if you will, is the addition... Oh, that's our faction leader, dear. Is the addition of the humans. Ruadauer makes up a massive part of their roster, and I quite like to build on that a little bit more by giving them a Ruadauran captain. Listen up! Now, what I'm not going to do, because it'll only take two turns, I am going to just siege them out, force them to attack me. Because then we don't have to worry about running into their archer fire. In the same sort of vein, actually, I'd be quite tempted to make... Why are all our watchtowers shut down? Oh, no, because we don't own that region. Dodoy. I am sieging Bari Donionak out. I'm not going to attack them, as I say... I was talking about this to Hotho Ploink in the comments, and or is it Hertha? Like, I'd really like you to phonetically spell out how to pronounce your name, because I'd like to know how to pronounce the O with the umlauts. But in the Khazad-dûm video, I attacked the army of the Dunlendings that was besieging northern Tharbad, and I had absolutely no need to. They would have attacked me. I could have just defended and easily killed all of them with far less losses. But as I was explaining to Hotho, the Khazad-dûm campaign... Oh, the High Lord of Moria is dead. Oh, that's interesting. The Khazad-dûm campaign is in the bag. We've won it. We literally have won it. Dunland can't do anything to hold us back now. The Orcs of the Misty Mountains are sufficiently... well, defeated is maybe not the right word, but they've been beaten down. They are subdued.
They're sleeping here. Kill them all.
And,
destroy them. Is that what you want?
Get ready for fighting.
Oh, look, there's an army of Breelanders outside. There's a factionary in here, and it's their capital. But the Dunlendings are basically beaten. Oh, the bloody elves are making their way through anyway, aren't they? Dunlendings are essentially beaten, as are the Misty Mountains. So I can afford to be a bit more cavalier in order to show off some more of our units, just fight more battles, that kind of thing. But in the Angmar campaign and in the Gondor videos, we are on the edge of a knife, really. That at any point, these campaigns could really turn. Like, the dwarves could suddenly show up, and then that's it, basically game over. Linden can actually pull their finger out of their ass, if you pardon, excuse my French, and actually wipe us away. If they gathered all their armies into one army, or even just two, they could easily beat us, easily see us defeated. But they just won't do that, because then the AI... Oh, they attack straight away. So I can afford to be a bit more casual in the Khazad-dûm campaign that I can't afford in this campaign, or in the Gondor campaign. The Woodland Realm one is a bit half and half, because if I incur the wrath of the Easterlings and Mordor at the same time, I might be in a bit of trouble, because I can't get enough troops out to counter the amount that they can kill. So even though they don't kill very many, and almost every battle goes my way,
let's pray it remains as such.
Every single loss you take in an Elven campaign is really, really crucial, if you're not yet at a point where you've really decisively won. Oh, hold on. Yeah, because we want to shut down their archers. If we run away, they're just going to fire arrows at us. So, that's why I was a bit cavalier with it. And we lost an awful lot, obviously. We lost an awful lot in that video, but... Idiots just lost their
Breelander. If we continue like this, we will smash the enemy.
Oh, there's the Golden Horns of Bree. I'm pretty sure they've got a new town square flag, actually.
Our men have taken control of the city.
The enemy comes. There we are. So, if you just keep chasing them forever, they'll not shoot, and then they'll just lose in 2 minutes because they're stupid. So unless they stand and fight, they're going to lose. Oh, there you go, they've stood. Right, there you go. This is the difference between a halberdier and a pike, although someone said they use a two-handed sword animation, but they don't. Well, this unit certainly doesn't, anyway. As you can see, they are swinging them, like that guy just there. Like, return to that gentleman. The guy just behind him is just doing it. They see that do that high over the head, axe down kind of chop. And then he's just done another one there where they sweep out wide. That's the halberd, the difference between the halberd and the pike. But as you can see, their base formation is the same as the pike, so holding it at arm's length, holding it out. Whereas a two-handed axe is held down to the side, and a two-handed sword, they kind of rest in their hands. But that is a really telltale position, that kind of, almost like holding a bucket kind of position. Like, you could replace that pike with a box, and that's how the pike and... But the halberd is split ever so slightly in that they, as I've just explained, it's split ever so slightly because they do the sweeping attacks. And that's what makes the halberd slightly worse. Where are they going? Someone kill him, go on. End it. Well, that was easy. The Dúnedain didn't do anything. Although we did lose 71 of them, 57-40. 142 kills, Orc Marauders, well done. Right, that town is taken back and all the enemy are dead. All the enemies are dead. Oh, I came across the passage in the Complete History of Middle-earth, the Christopher Tolkien books that I've got. I came across a passage whereby the two blue wizards are given their alternative names. Which I thought was interesting. Oh, that was a bigger Breeland general just on the horizon there, wasn't it? And the crux of the episode, the fight for Bari Donionach. Captain Pelendur has got some men-at-arms, a Ballister, and Dúnedain Rangers. Not too much. And Phylion from within has 2 units of siege, a lot of cavalry, 4 units of cavalry. So aside from cavalry and siege, his army's not... Well, Wardens, Blade... It's a good army. It is going to be a slog. But we've got 3 generals. We've not just come at this lightly. So I'm thinking maybe send in some wargs to shut down the Ballister and the Rangers, and we'll take down the Arthedain men-at-arms with our generals, kill them as quickly as we can, and then turn and face, because we're going to be being attacked from behind. But the chance for victory is ours. That one's come up quite a lot now, hasn't it? There are like 250 or something loading screens, and the same ones come up. That's why I'd rather that they weren't random and that they just went in a set loop. I would much prefer that. Right, we are currently here. Pelendur is going to be right there on the other side of that hill, and he'll just come straight at us. But Phylion is going to be coming from here. See, we could really cut down on... I'm tempted to shut him down straight away because we know where he's coming from. Or is he going to be more central, actually? I think he might be more central. But still, we got that chance to just shut him down immediately. Take his cavalry out of the game and just swamp him. And then turn and deal with the other guy. Because we haven't got any archers. But he's definitely coming from the side. Because Phylion was attacking us from the top right. So we were besieging the city facing this... Yeah, he's definitely going to come in from here. I think we will. I think we will just deal with them. So line everyone up to squeeze them between us. Those of you who have not been used, come in behind, ready to make positions. And the 2 warg units stand by on the hill to deal with the other guy. Who have I missed? Oh, our javelin throwers. And the cavalry. So cavalry on top of the hill as well. Javelins, you can go there. Boom. No, pause. Perfect placement. Right. So he's got Cav coming around the side, so send you and you both run out there. Off you go. So, you. I want you to run to there straight away. You move up to support. Two units of fellas move up as well. Should have just put everyone on the line. Should have just put everyone on the line. All three of you just literally block them. Beat them to the edge. They can't sprint. That's the only advantage we have here. The enemy cannot sprint until they are on the battle map. So we have one little cheeky advantage. Right, you don't get involved because you're our actual leader. So you go and stand up there. The deaths of the others won't matter as much as your death. And our cav will do what it can to just keep that busy once they start becoming a bit of a problem. So our cav just move up to there. Oh, and I forgot about you. Run up. And you, come to them. Oh, wrong button. There we are. Move yourselves in.
If we continue like this, we will smash the enemy.
Perfect. Taking the cavalry out of the game. Brilliant, brilliant. What of those on the other side? Nothing doing just yet. Our cavalry's in position. You two run over there. Ah, that cavalry got through. That cavalry has not got through. Zoom in, sorry. Oh, I've not paid so much attention. If we can cut this army down with very, very minimal losses, we are on for such a good win here. They charged our cav, that's interesting. An enemy general has fallen. Phalion's already gone. Oh, those ballisters are shooting, but their cavalry is engaging our captain. That's right, they'll be dead soon. The wilds are moving in. How goes it over there? Right, we've got them totally surrounded. Units are routing. Push through. That down there is dead. You guys come up there. Assist.
The enemy are badly bloodied.
Sort of charge.
They have lost half their men.
Pull out. And the wags? Oh, excellent. The ballisters are down. Right, so then our only real threat now remains to be the Arthedain men-at-arms. Who we might be able to surround with our... Keep them busy with our lots of routing going on. We've only lost 10%. 50% of the enemy has died. It's a bit cheesy, I suppose, but... Hit those Dunedain rangers. You go there, you go there, you actually attack them. General, come in behind. Ah, oh, those wargs are done. Dunedain rangers, getting some shots in on our general. But the men of Ruadal steam across the hill. Cut them asunder. And Captain Pelander falls in that brutal charge. Ah, but now we really need to move, get a jiggle on. Because our general's just been engaged by the enemy. Ah, oh, I'm still wearing. Oh, we've completely routed them. So it's just the men-at-arms left. Yeah, that's basically it. 13% of us so far have died, but our general's in very real threat of actually dying.
The enemy are badly
bloodied. Ah, no, they're broken. There we
go. They have lost half their men.
Broken men maybe get one or two kills, but nothing major. An absolutely outrageous victory. Captain Phylian got quite a few to get away, though. Quite a few survived. And 84 was our greatest kills. Rudau's scouts. Well done. Well done indeed. Oh, look at those. That's an interesting image events, isn't it? What's that behind? Men of Rohan. The men of Rohan.
It's a trap!
No! Kill them all. They managed to rebuild their training ground in the short time they held their town.
We've destroyed the enemy!
A cracking victory. Absolutely splendid. A Bari Donyanak falls into our hands with minimal losses, which means we can now press out, reinforce Barketta, and deal with the enemy that we are now going to face. Linden. Good, our general's just gotten.
Listen up!
Right, so. Merge together, leave behind 40 of them, 44 of them, and maybe the 78 of them, and the rest of you.
Come on!
You're off to Barketta.
We have completed an objective.
Which doesn't have any defences. Well, we can destroy that. This doesn't do anything for us. What's the free upkeep here? Oh, three. Ah, that's interesting. What are the men of Rudau being retrained for? We might as well just remove them, to be honest.
My lord.
Marvellous. Marvellous. Ah, there they are. Councilman Andy the Scout, the faction heir of Bree, makes his way to Nofer Rochlor. Very well. We're going to need to throw a little bit more at it.
Come on!
They won't get there in time, though, will they? And we'll die if we face them.
Defeating you.
Oh, Bree, you're actually doing something. Well, at least if we combine our army into one. Right, have it. Take it. Take the bloody place. And then, at least then our army, he won't be able to catch us. No. So we can join together and take it with the most strength that we could possibly give for it. Still going to be a close bloody fight, though.
Objective.
Oh, he's our faction heir. And Overlord Agmaz is our leader. Sieging the last remnants of Ant. Again, I'm not going to attack that. We'll siege them out for 9 turns. They don't have anywhere else in the north. This and Keloniak are now their only remaining 2 provinces, I believe. But we'll see. We'll see. We'll see. Give it another 10 turn. We're drastically losing money. We need to do something. Anything. Start turning it around. At least we've still got fast turn times. I haven't spoken of that in a while. Thought I'd throw that in there. I was watching Age of Empires related comment, but I just wanted to say it because it really amazed me. I was watching the Escape Masters first match of the third place game between Doubt and Backed, two expert players, and it was Berbers versus Mongols, which we in the kind of amateur scene that I play in and occasionally pop up on YouTube have come to the conclusion very quickly that the Berbers are such an outrageous counter to the Mongols that only a fool would opt to play that way, to go for that kind of matchup. Now, I can appreciate that in this Escape Masters or whatever, that they may not have had a choice. They may have been randomised teams.
No sleeping here.
Listen up. Oh, regroup, come on.
And but even so, knowing that the Camel Archer totally 100% counters the Mangadai and the Cavalry Archers, Mangadai and Cavalry Archers, when one of these expert players then built an army of Mangadai, I just couldn't believe it. I was absolutely astounded. Surely they must know that Camel Archers counter them. How can you not know? I was just so amazed. So amazed.
Listen up.
But that's what they did. An army of Mangadai. They got shredded and the guy lost. I mean, still, he's a much better player than me, and I'll give him that. I'm not saying anything to that. But I was just really amazed that an expert player would still chance his arm for a unit that is a 100% countered by the other guy's unique unit. Especially when he knew that the other gentleman had a full army of Camel Archers. Why he tried to match it with Mangadai, I just don't know. It's like saying, like, the enemy's got a line of well-trained, disciplined infantrymen, and all we've got are swordsmen. Or they've got a line of well-trained, disciplined riflemen with modern weapons, right? So think of your army right now, whatever country you're in, your army standing in a line and running across the field at them are a load of swordsmen. Trying to build Mangadai to counter the camel archers is like trying to build more swordmen than the other team has bullets. Like, that is basically what the only way to beat them with Mangadai. And it was just madness. He would have needed so much and so many resources. Anyway, sorry. I'm totally unrelated to this. I've been blabbering because I'm trying to think what to do with Bree. Bree, who have for so long been a non-entity, are suddenly crawling out of the woodwork with quite the armies.
It will be an honor defeating you.
Now, I know that we actually are like for like there, but they've got their faction heir, and look at his command. We could see some real danger here. We could have genuine threat from Bree, while our entire force is focused on the west. And we are only not... We're not making any money.
Be gone.
Captain Andy has seized this opportunity. He must have started moving out the second this region fell to us. I can't imagine how he would have got here any quicker. And we just don't have anything. I've got no reserves. My whole army is used up. The Innuminous army is going to have to win and then immediately come back and fight against Bree. Which means that Chief Grashkur, Grashuk, you're going to have to deal with Linden completely in its entirety. You're our Linden buffer. And in here, I just have no idea.
Come and get me.
Captain Walt's going to take Knopfler a claw because we don't have anyone in it. I'd quite like it to enter open revolt, to be honest, because... Oh, no, it will join Bree. It will definitely join Bree. Oh, dear. And it earns a lot of money, 700. It's a huge hit if we lose
that.
I can't move anyone closer, though. I just can't do anything else.
Sleeping here.
Oh, I'm not... Something... It's all for the next episode, I'm afraid. Oh, that's going to have to end that one. So thank you very much for watching, if indeed you have. I'm Arachir Galadirathan. If you've got any feedback, comments, questions, pop them in the comments below and I'll get round to having a read and reply to those. But until we speak again, dear friends, Navar Naden Pedamad Melunin, and farewell.